in their hand so that they could go in search of metal cans or any such a sort of metal things. And the other child would go and pick up plastic. So this was her story. She didn't really expect
it. You know, and you had to throw. Did you really think before you did that? Not all of us make a conscious effort of doing that. Now, like you can see, I've put these two pictures because something that is not really required for you is very valuable for somebody else there. So it's always important. It's not just food. It's more than food, any material that can be used and can be valued. Now, what will happen if we continue to do this? That is, not think and just throw. What will happen? This is what will happen. And this is already happening, unfortunately. This is already happening. We have seen all this happen. I'm sure all of you would have crossed that place there. Like something like this, closing your nose and blaming the government, the BBMP, to do something about it. Especially when it's raining. You have the cows also there for an example of it. But do you think more than that? I mean, yes, you are in traffic, stuck up there because of the garbage, because of the cow, because of the rain. But what did you think? I mean, have you thought about how you can reduce this mess? Did you ever think that the cow that's feeding here is the cow that will actually give you milk? So if you poison the cow, it is giving you something poisoned. So you need to think before you throw. Another thing, here again, we're burning. It's easy to say, okay, just burn that, you know. At least it will be into ashes. I will not have to see it. But the smoke that is generated out of it is worse than, you know, it being there. And this is what happens in landfills. People go there and burn because there's no space. There is no more place for a landfill. You know, probably sooner or later, the empty land next to yours will become a landfill. Because it's already becoming, I mean, the place that is a dump yard next to you is sort of a small scale landfill, you can call it. So there have been many companies that have done research on a bag that you throw out. They think that a bag of waste is actually a resource that is wasted. Now this statistics that they've got is depending on the weight of the bag. So 60% of what you throw is organic waste. It is from the waste that comes out of your kitchen. So the things that you waste, the fruit and vegetable peel, something that's, you know, been in the fridge for too long and you forgot, something like those. There is 20% that can be recycled. Now these are all the plastic, metal, glass. There is 10% that is toxic, which includes your e-waste and your medical waste. And finally, there is something that has to go to the landfill, unfortunately. So if we actually look into this bag, you will only be throwing 10% of the waste, which is supposed to go to the landfill, but you know, you're throwing 100% of it. So did you know that a family of 2 to 4 people generate around 0.5 kg to 1 kg of waste per day? And this is just the kitchen waste that is produced. And just imagine, you as an individual are throwing out 1 kilo of waste. How many houses in your locality, in your city, in your country, in your state, whatever? And you know, it just multiplies. And all of this kitchen waste can be converted into something more useful, which is manure, which is compost, which is biogas. All this can be used again, used for, you know, to make your soil more fertile. It is losing the fertility because of landfills. Now, composting will help you, will help the soil regain its fertility. Why did all this happen? I mean, we will, yes, blame our parents, our grandparents, the government, that, you know, they should have taken care of it. It was not our mistake. I will stop throwing it today, but what about the things that have been thrown? So what has happened is, before the problem happened, we didn't see it. They didn't see the problem is going to be this big. They didn't know that garbage is going to be such a big problem. And if you actually look back, we didn't line our dustbins with plastic then. 10 years ago, I have never seen my mom do it. But because we have got lazy, we don't want to clean our dustbins, we have started lining it with plastic. There is no other reason. You just want your house to be clean. you do not care what happens. So now, next is when the problem happened, we didn't recognize that this was a problem. Yes, you saw those cemented rings that into which you used to put your, black cover. But you didn't realize that, okay, someday it's going to be a big problem. There is also a question that why have they removed all the cemented rings? Do anybody of us know that? There are very few cemented rings now. Do you see any of the cemented rings are there? Why do you think that happened? They removed, the BVMP decided to remove it. But if it is kept open, it will still go, right? I mean, the reason for removing those was people had started putting babies into the bins, into those bins. They started putting a lot of biomedical waste which was not supposed to be there. And, you know, especially with the problem of the girl child thing, you know, people not accepting, they used to throw away. Even fetuses, they were thrown away into these things. So they had to stop this, and BBMP said, okay, if it is exposed, then they will not do it. So that's the reason why they removed it. Now, when we recognized this was a problem, we didn't try to solve it. So all of us know that waste is a problem, but what did we do about it? Have you changed, has anybody of you, have you changed anything about it? Yes, you know waste is a problem. When you pass by, you say, oh God, this is India, it's so dirty. Oh yeah, it's India, it's okay, yaar. Ho jata hai, it's okay. You know, the BBMP guy will come someday and clean it. But how many of us have tried, made an effort to solve it? Now, when we tried to solve it, it failed. I think that we are still in stage 3. There is still possibility for us to make a change. Let's not fail with this. Yes, a lot of people are trying to do something about it, but it will not happen with just, say, 10 people. It has to happen with everybody. Because the mentality is, okay, I am going to segregate, but what about my neighbor? He's not doing it. Why should I do it? And maybe you can put it the other way around. Maybe your neighbor will think, oh God, you know what? That guy is segregating. Why shouldn't I do it? Let's get it that way and not, you know, the first kind. Let us be the reason for change and not wait for change to happen. So what can we do to stop this, you know, going to the last level is, I'm sure you would have all heard about these 3 R's. Reduce, reuse, recycle. So again, have you done something about it? Yes, you've heard about a lot of it, but especially last year, around the same time in October, BBMP said, okay, if you do not segregate, we're not going to take your waste. So people said, okay, because my waste is not going to go out of my house, I'm going to segregate. But what happened again? You saw that the BBMP was putting the waste together again. So you said, my effort is going into vain. You know, why should I segregate? I segregate at home, they put it back together in the same place. Why should I segregate? Do you have an answer why you should still segregate? Or
because industries, they don't have technology to segregate. Or if they have, it is very costly.
Correct, but if the BBMP is mixing it, why do you have to segregate?
I have not seen segregating in white people, where I
colorize. So,
no, but then there are those BBMP notices everywhere that if you don't segregate, you'll be fined and everything.
Correct. So why are you waiting for them to put a fine on you? I mean, only if you have to, yeah, it's not fair, right?
No, the reason why we don't segregate is, for example, right? It's 1 kg of waste every day at my house.
Hmm.
They segregate it.
Hmm.
I need to have 3 separate dustbins.
Hmm.
Right? And for all of these 3 to get filled, it will take a week.
Correct.
Right? I cannot keep throwing 3 packets every day because I'm wasting plastic.
Okay.
Right? Out of my 1 kg waste, I have 200 grams of, 800 grams of organic waste and 200 grams of something else.
So it's okay to mix and throw?
You're not.
See, so what happens this when I keep it? So I need to keep 2 bins. I put the 800 gram here, I put 200 here.
Hmm.
I cannot throw it because it's still not filled.
Okay.
I need to keep it for another day. So this one is filled. My other waste is still lying there. It is not filled yet.
Okay.
So I'm not going to throw it. I need to keep that trash for a week for it to get filled.
So right. What happens?
Or even in case of electronic waste.
Huh.
I throw like 5 batteries a month.
Hmm.
That's the max electronic waste that I throw.
Correct.
If I have to segregate it and throw, I need to keep that trash can for a year. Right?
What's the
Only
harm?
Only then that will get filled.
What's the harm?
We don't have space at home, right?
For 5 batteries?
No,
for
5
dustbins.
Dustbins.
No, you don't have to buy a dustbin to segregate. You have old carton boxes, you have a space that you're not really using. You segregate in those. You don't need dustbins to segregate. And let me tell you, if you do not mix your waste, it will not stink. The reason waste smells is because of the wet waste. Now, if you know how to treat your wet waste, then there's no problem of storing waste.
Now, she is still talking about throwing wet waste away.
Wet waste you have to throw it away.
But the other way is, if I have to segregate it and collect it and then give it off, then I need to maintain it somewhere for a larger period of time. Which, that's why we're not doing it. That's what I feel. Right? And if you're trying to collect electronic waste, you need to collect it for over a year. That means you have one carton box kept in your house to put the electronic waste, and you need to maintain it over a year so that it's filled. Then you throw
okay.
it away.
Even biomedical.
So instead of keeping that one carton there for a year, I just throw those 5 batteries with my regular trash.
Okay, so I would like to ask, do you live in an apartment or an individual home?
I live in an apartment. Yeah.
Apartment. So it's an advantage for you that you're living in an apartment, because it's not just you who's going to segregate, it's 10 or 20 other people there. So what you could do as a champion in your apartment would be make sure that there is one bin that is for e-waste. So instead of throwing out waste in 1 year, you are throwing it out in say a month.
Right, yeah. So this could
that makes more sense.
Yeah.
Yes.
There are apartments who are doing it. So what happens when you're in a separate
individual house, there are many e-waste agencies. There are many places that are certified to collect e-waste. You just, even if you have one battery, you go and drop it in their place.
Yes,
it is better than mixing it. Now I'll tell you why.
Collecting things are not there, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
They're not there. So for example, in, see the whole of Whitefield, we don't have a separate bin where you put e-waste. So I have to mix it and trash. I'm ready to do it. I'm just telling why we are not able to do it.
So there's nothing stopping anybody to go to a local mall and championing the mall to actually set up an e-waste collection. We're talking about taking social responsibility and saying that if you recognize the problem, such as, okay, there isn't a place, why not go to a mall, why not go to somewhere people go to frequently and actually ask them to participate. They may say no, but out of the 5 to 10...
Just accepting as a problem and looking at it from a solution perspective.
That's like being an entrepreneur.
Yeah.
That's like, you know, you're waiting. See, you don't wait for somebody. So what I'm trying to say is be a champion to do something. So what we're doing right now is, you know, we're waiting for a solution to happen. How much are we going to wait? How long are we going to wait? So how do we manage it? It is as simple as segregating it into two different categories. One is biodegradable, which means that was... it had life before. The other is non-biodegradable, which includes your dry waste, your e-waste, your bio-waste, you know, all of these. Mainly, these are the two categories. Now, this is what happens to each of the category. Your first part of it, which is the garden and the kitchen waste, all of this can be composted at home. So you can convert your kitchen waste into manure for your plants. You do not have to throw it out. And the best part is, there have been so many companies that have come up with so many solutions that it doesn't make it smell. The reason why people don't want to keep their wet waste at home, because it smells. It stinks. And yes, obviously it will. So do something, go Google. I mean, you Google so much, yaar. Google something useful. So the next category is reuse and recycle. Now what happens here is, when I say reuse, you can reuse all your plastics, paper, metal, glass, all your beer cans, all of that. I mean, that is so much more useful. Now what you're doing other than segregate, when you segregate, what is another thing that you're doing is you're helping the people who have to sit and segregate your waste. That is your shit, literally. Because they have to put their hands into injections, syringes, sanitary napkins, diapers, broken glass pieces, newspapers, kitchen waste. I mean, all of this is what they have to put their hands into. Why should they do it? What rights do you have to make them do this? So, and like I said, there's 10% only that is toxic, which is your e-waste and medical waste. If you live in a community, like especially an apartment, you are in an advantage because you together can collect all the waste and you can dispose it in a safer way. You tie up with an e-waste agency, you tie up with a hospital, they will help you. If you're not asking for it, nobody will give you, not even a job. So you need to go and find one. Until unless, yeah, you're really good, they will come to you. Now there is 10% that goes to the landfill. Unfortunately, we have a lot of things in this category, which includes your Tetra Paks, your Lay's chips, your Kurkure, your biscuit packets. Why? Because they are all fused materials. They cannot be separated and recycled. So what we could do is reduce the consumption of these items. What I mean by them, that is, I will explain you in each thing. So there are a few examples of how you can manage your waste. One is your kitchen and your garden waste. You can compost it, because why do you need to compost it? Because the soil needs the nutrients back, like I've already told, and the landfill does not require your waste. It does not require at least this kind of waste, your garden or your kitchen waste. Another way is biogas. If you're working for a big company or a hotel, where food is prepared there, this will be very useful because you can use the biogas to heat something, to cook something. And again, why not? Instead of throwing to the landfill, why not use it in a smarter way? Then is the dry waste. Like I said, avoid packaged food, all the chips and the biscuits that I was talking about, at least reduce using them. Yes, an Oreo is really tempting. I love Oreo. But you know, when I got to know that it's really bad, it's not just the packaging. Now, if you take a biscuit, buy a biscuit or a chips from, say, your hot chips or your bakery, how long do you think it will stay for? No, from bakery. From a natural bakery that was an Iyengar bakery, which usually... For a week, maximum 10 days. And then it's gone. Why do you think that happens?
No preservatives.
So all your packaged food, they might say no preservatives, but how is it going to stay? It does have preservatives. All of them do. We say that don't eat... these ready-made stuff. Some of us say, no, because it has packaged. All the other things also do. See, what you can reduce is how you can help, how you can be the solution. It's not like you can't tell Britannia, you close your company. They can't, right? At least you can ask them to change the way they pack. If one person goes, it will not happen. If 10 people go, there might be a small change that you can make. So, together, maybe, you can go and do that.
In fact, I have a thing, and I was studying marketing. In some country, I don't know exactly where, what happens is a lot of our bottles, right? Our bottles have stickers on them,
okay. Right?
Like a paper sticker or a wrapper on them. So what happens is when you try to recycle these things, what happens is the wrapper, the process is not fine. Well defined in India at least. So what happens is we have to tear off the wrapper, put it in another, and the plastic bottle in another, so that it can be reused. What happens in, I think, Germany, I don't remember exactly, is that there's a lobby of NGOs who said that if you have to stick something, write it on the bottle, not on a sticker and then stick it on the bottle. So what happens is, even if your shampoo or Clinic
mm-hmm.
Plus or whatever, it does not have any plastic label or sticker on it, because the segregation becomes simpler because you're just embossing
yeah.
or in engraving the whatever content you have to directly on the bottle and not in the wrapper and then wrap it. So it actually has already happened if you lobby for it.
Just out of business curiosity, is that cheaper also?
I don't know.
I
this
think it might be.
Embossing is
cheaper than embossing. Embossing, if you are using OHP marker rather than a normal marker and writing it on a plastic bottle, I think that's what he means.
Yeah, or directly just use a
print.
Print like
yeah, like a print, like you have on your Bisleri bottles. You know, one more thing about bottles are, you know, you don't know where that water was. Okay, where does natural water come from? Good water, rivers. All of the fresh water source. So obviously it's not coming from the tap that is really close to your house. They will not do it, I mean, pack it there. So by the time it is reaching your house, yeah, that is if you're reusing the bottle, by the time it's going to reach your house or reach you, you don't know how long it's been packaged there for. And what is it packaged in? Plastic. The cap is plastic. The label around it is plastic. You know, you're like surrounded by plastic. So, I mean, we might think, this water is so dirty, I think I'll take bottled water. Do you know how long that bottled water is, I mean, that water has been in that bottle? How much chemical that bottle itself would have, generated into the water? We wouldn't have thought so much when you drink water. So that's why, there's a lot of thing that reuse the bottle. At least that way you will reduce poisoning yourself. This another thing when I say not just avoiding, is to reduce the use of some things. Like say, all of us eat a lot of rice and chapati. Now, why not buy rice in gunny sacks? Why do you want to buy them in plastic? There's an option of doing that. Like I said, why buy biscuits that are packaged? Why not go to the bakery guy and buy it? Hot chips. You know, there is a kind of plastic that cannot be recycled. That's because there is a value of plastic. There's a high value plastic, there's a low value plastic. Your kabadi wala won't take all sort of plastic. He might even take it from you, but he will not pay you anything for it. And even if you say, nahi yaar, rakh lo, you know, you're being nice, you're telling, okay, no, I don't need money. Even then, he's going to throw it back into the drain. He is not educated. All of us are. That is what we think we are. Right? So next is, okay, you've avoided it. But still, I mean, there's a lot of plastic around us. So let's segregate and then let's aggregate. So you first keep it aside and then you put it together. Only when you have enough of material, you can go and sell it. As simple as your newspapers. Why haven't we stopped giving newspapers to kabadi walas? We still have value, right? All of us, I mean, all offices, all houses, they still aggregate newspapers and then you sell it. The same thing can be done with your metal, plastic, glass. If kept neatly and in a good condition, yes. So first you avoid whatever plastic that you can get home, segregate it, aggregate it, sell it, and if possible, reuse it. Reuse how I will show you. So there is a dry waste collection center in the outskirts of Bangalore where all the waste go and then they segregate it. So if you see here, this place, this is how it's thrown. And then there are ladies here who have to sit. Their job is that. You know, the job is that to sit and segregate each of your waste. Put plastic into one, put a high value plastic into one, put a low value plastic into one. Why can't we make it a little easier for them? Just a little. Only by you putting it into different bins. So next is the e-waste, like you said. Aggregate and tie up with e-waste agencies like e-parisara. There have been so many companies. It need not be an e-waste company. There are so many waste management companies. Now what they're trying to do is they say, okay, let us get certified to be at least able to collect something like these. and then we give it to, I mean, you might not, as an individual, I might not be able to reach an e-waste agency, but at least as a group, you go and give it to some companies like this, and then they deliver it to some other places. Why you need to do this? How many of you are techies here? I'm sure you all love gadgets. And I'm sure you all know, okay, even if you're not a techie, how many of you have a phone here? How many of you love phones here, rather?
Yeah.
So, think before you buy a new phone. I'm not telling don't buy a new phone, but before you buy a new phone, see how you're going to use a new old one. Okay? See what is the value of the old one. You know that a phone is not just plastic and glass. It has a lot more chemicals in it. So by just throwing it on the ground will not work. If suppose I ask any of you to come here and stand and I give you a piece of biscuit, ask you to dip it into Dettol and eat it, how many of you will eat it? Rather, will anybody of you eat it? No. Okay, I'll say now wash it and eat it. Will you still eat it? You wouldn't, because the biscuit is already contaminated. Now that is what happens to your land. When you mix your kitchen waste, your batteries, your plastic, your metal, all of it together, it is not only taking the space, you know, it's not reducing the space for you, but also it is harming your soil from where your food grows. It is harming your water from where you get your groundwater. It is harming your air which you breathe in. Now you are responsible, rather we are responsible for it. So if you are happy that you don't have waste in your house and it's outside your apartment, sorry boss, if you have groundwater coming to your apartment, it's already poisoned. So you know, if you see somebody throwing waste there, if you think yaar it's okay, jaane dena, it's okay, it's not okay. It's more than just throwing waste. Now, yeah, that's about, you know, they need to, again, segregate. Like, you can see all these. I'm sure you're all familiar with all these different kinds of words. I just know a few. Battery, plastic. So, I'm sure you'll know more about that. Finally, let's go to the bio-waste. Now, bio-waste, like I said, only 10% of it goes to the landfill. And that is only, that means that's supposed to go to the landfill. And this can be put into a paper, newspaper. You wrap it in the newspaper and throw it. Dead animals, when I mean, say, a rat or a cockroach, you will not have all those every day. Hair, yes, you might, because your water is polluted, yeah, there will be a lot of hair fall. It's obvious. Then there are cigarette butts. For all those who smoke, please throw it to the landfill. Don't sit and, you know, don't tell, arey yaar usme weed and all that. No, no, you don't have to go to the landfill. You will die if you go there. Don't even think of going there. Then broken glass pieces. Unfortunately, it's because it's mixed, right? It's not possible to do something out of it. Until unless it's aggregated. Then there are diapers and sanitary napkins that have to go, because even sending, putting it into a incinerator won't help. And then there are fused materials, like I said, chips covers, tetra packs, all these have to go.
One thing I would like to add is tetra packs. I was attending a session in Kondo, so that the company itself was saying that they have a technology to recycle
tetra packs. Yeah, so recently they have come up with, you know, roofing. So all the tetra packs that are there, they help in making the roofs. Like the plastic, you reuse plastic and make it. Tetra packs also help. But what I'm trying to say is, yes, roofing sab ho jayega, but after that, what? What is the end result? Like, say a kitchen waste, you consider kitchen waste, it can be converted into manure, which will go back to the soil. It can be converted into biogas, which is used for cooking. But this again cannot, you know, there's no end to it. It's a cycle. It's actually a cycle that has to be followed. So what can you do as techies? non-techies also can do this. Reduce what you throw. First of all, think before you throw. Maybe, or think in the way how you can throw it. Segregate at home and at office. If you think it's difficult to start at home, start with office. Make a group. We make a lot of groups. Go for dinner, blah, blah, blah. Why not make a group and say, okay, all of us in this room are going to segregate. I don't care about others. Or do it in your own table, on your own table. You don't have to keep two different dustbins. You can just keep a box, a small box. How much waste do you generate in your office? Very little, right? So a banana peel, throw it into a different thing. And a paper, throw it into a different thing. So you start. Maybe the person next to you someday will learn something from you. Yeah, this is something that maybe you can do. Come up with an awesome app or a game that will help people understand segregation better in a fun way. Not all of us know about segregation and how to do it. Maybe you people can help them in some way. There are a lot of apps that have come up. Make a useful one also. Thank you. It's about waste management only. So we help people convert kitchen waste into compost. There are composters that can be taken home. It's made of terracotta. And yeah, compost, I segregate, reduce the waste. And I live in an apartment, so all the dry waste goes to another place. Yes, when my friends come home, I shout at them when they throw it in the wrong dustbin. I say, mujhe karna padega ye sab, khud karo. So yeah, they listen to me, they're really nice people.
There was a recent article that I was reading that there is some fungi or algae which they have found out in Africa which can actually decompose plastic. They're looking at researchers to produce it more.
True. It can be done if you segregate. Everything starts if you segregate. Yes, that's what I'm telling. Value what you throw. If it is kept separately, each one of it can be used. Now, the plastic, even here, right? What happens? I showed you the dry waste collection center. It goes there, and there's a machine which converts it into smaller pellets. From there, they make new chairs, new bowls, new buckets. So, you know, it's reused again. So, there's some value to it only if it is kept separately, not if you mix it. Like I said, the biscuit and Dettol. I mean, why would you eat even if it is washed? You know it's already contaminated.
So people are tweeting, their tweets are getting displayed. Ruchir said something really interesting, I guess. People are arguing.
Any other questions? I mean, with respect to waste management.
I think we should
also come
with some guidelines at home. Like, my wife, she uses napkins for almost everything. So if there is something spilled on the kitchen slab, she immediately takes out the kitchen towel, which is again a basement, and she wipes it off. So whereas that's not that great of practice. You can always use a cloth and, wash it and use it again. Right, so there are certain small things which we can actually
rethink.
Right, so what we can do is we can maybe make a chart for ourselves at home as to what is the consumption of your toilet papers, your kitchen towels per month, and then try to reduce it over the years. You can actually see what is the difference that you're made. You're using 5 rolls a month. And
that's like a bad threat. It's worse than paying a fine. You know, your waste is not going to go out of your house. It's going to sit in the house and stink. That's worse than, paying him 100 rupees. Arey yaar, le lo, please, mera waste le lo. Please take it away. I don't want it at my house. So it's, your condition is that bad. I mean, if it's, I don't know which language, but I think Sanskrit. Dandam Dashagunam. If you need that, then I'm sorry, boss. You'll have to wait for the BBMP to say, okay, if you don't do this, I'm going to put a fine. If you do this, okay. If you are that kind of a person, then I don't know. I'm sorry for you.
So there's another thing. Another reason why we should be segregating is that the plastic waste that is there, it does not really have to go to a landfill. It can be compacted and made into a road. I mean, you can build roads out of plastic waste.
See, we have ideas, it's just not being implemented.
I guess it's just a business opportunity.
In fact, it's currently going on for the potholes they're trying. Because the current tar is not working, they're trying alternate methods. And in fact, in countries like Sweden, they have to export plastic. And things like that, because most of their electric needs, basic energy needs, are fulfilled by generating electricity out of.
And also, why do you think all your drainages are really bad? Because what is happening, all the smaller plastics, right? Like your, lot of people eat pan. Lot of us use a sachet of shampoo. Okay? I would suggest you use a bottle, a smaller bottle of shampoo. You know, anyways, you know all of you need shampoo, but then why use a small sachet? Because that, nobody is going to clean it. It will go down the drain. You are causing the, you say, arey yaar, they can't clean the drain or what? Why are you even dirtying it for them to clean it for you? And another thing is, yes, I'm paying tax. Why the hell should I do this? Why the hell can the BBFP come and take up this thing? Why do you think they should do it? You're paying tax. That's enough, right? That's not enough. You know, people...
Tax money can go to better way. Why waste tax money?
Yeah, why waste tax money? There's something else that can be... And also, you know, the amount of waste that is being transported from one place to another, to such big trucks. We don't really need these big trucks. They are overloaded. And that's the reason that your roads are bad. You know, your roads are not meant to take that much weight. There's so much petrol, diesel going into those vehicles, which is... maybe can be used for your own vehicles. Why are you wasting it on something that is, not required?
It's not just about the landfills. Where this plastic goes, it goes in smaller cities, and when you go around, greener areas is very important. I have cleaned up a national park, and it was just like 800 meters of road, and we had like 30 kgs of plastic. Imagine.
Yeah, I know.
It's just on the road. Just on the road. Sides of the road. Not even inside.
There's a movie called Plastic Cow. Have you seen it?
The Plastic Cow. The story of stuff. The Plastic Cow. There's so many.
Each cow has 50 kilos of plastic.
See? I think I mentioned that, Yes, you think, milk is healthy. One glass in the morning, one glass at night. And a lot of exercise. Sorry, boss, you're feeding.
That is coming from dairy farms.
It's coming from the farms, but what are they fed with?
They are captive.
Really? How do they grow those, grains? What's going into the soil? There's a very close to all these farms there are landfills. You might have not seen it. It's just outside your house. We're not busy with the city life. I mean, and the places that we go to is like really green and nice. But have you really been to a landfill? Have you been even close to a landfill?
Yeah, yeah.
You have? That's nice. If you want to go, actually if you want to know the fate of your trash, just go start from your house, get down, see, and go and explore. You will reach the landfill and you will know when you reach the landfill.
In fact, there is a weekly tour happens by some NGO which shows you how plastic is done, how buckets are made out of plastic.
Correct. There are day
dumps. And in fact, I'm working on a project on cows. Actually, I was showing this image. If you can, it's too small, but it's a cow which actually puts its head within that small. Around hotels, you have these things where people dry plates all the time.
So, that's what I mean. I was seeing a video. I thought I'd put up a video. In that video, it shows, from the time you're born, so the baby is, the bottle, right? What is it made of?
Plastic.
So, it's that there. And till death. So, that was the video. They covered the dead body with the big
caskets. Caskets are in plastic?
The coffins?
Coffins are in plastic?
No,
they are wood. There is also plastic. If the people can't afford, they do plastic.
That's why Indian Railways made a rule that teacups will be made of mud.
There is no rule to certain...
Some kind of
Laluji.
And actually there is a rule. you know, if you don't segregate 500 rupees, fine. If you don't, you know, if you throw in the neighbor site, it's 200 rupees, fine. It's just that the BBMP is being nice to you that they're not taking the fine. So before they, you know, are really, before it's really difficult for you to survive, let's start doing something about it.
So the thing is it possible that, see, the reason we keep newspapers at home is that we can sell it to the kabaddi wala.
Correct.
Is it also possible that we set up some shop which actually buys waste from you?
The kabaddi wala itself will take your plastic waste if it is a high-value plastic waste.
So what I'm trying to say is not just the plastic waste, all waste. If it is segregated, we can sell your waste. And then that waste is used for some, let's say, you know, industrial methane gas generation. The wet waste can go into that. Road creation for your plastic waste and other things, you know. Of course, you have to incinerate some bit of it. But is there a business opportunity there?
There is something called OWC, Organic Waste Converter. Mm-hmm. They, you know, all the organic waste is converted into biogas or manure. So there are a lot of opportunities online if you really want
to. I think there's a lady who just got a patent on something, converting plastic to
diesel, I guess.
Yeah.
So what I'm asking is there a business opportunity here? Because that would basically give a sort of an incentive to people to start segregating.
They're called kabaddi walas.
They do. If you give them a broken glass bill, obviously it will burst. Please take it to your house. So, you know, there's something that you need to be a little nice to him, yeah? Why? Come on, you're earning so much and you expect him to pay you for the waste that he's taking out of your house. That's not fair, right?
Come to kabaddi walas with plastic. He says you throw it in the...
That's because it might be a low-value plastic.
No, any plastic he doesn't want.
How much did you take?
He wants only newspapers.
How much did you take?
About 2 kilos of thing.
No, come on. 2-3
Volume wise, I think this much bag, this much like that. This much.
Yeah, it's the weight. So the weight of the, again, newspaper, you'll tell, you know, I took one newspaper. He will not give you money for one newspaper.
No, but he says there is no aftermarket value for that plastic.
No, it depends on like,
depends on the
who they can sell it to.
Yeah.
Yes.
The access that they have.
So if you give business, if you give milk packets, they'll buy because a lot of people will buy milk packets. Give plastic bottles to buy because a lot of people buy plastic bottles.
And,
so it depends on what he can do with what you give. You know, he's not going to process and like solidify the plastic pack and or convert it into gas. It's just a medium.
And if you see e-waste, no kabaddi wala takes e-waste.
No, kabaddi walas don't take e-waste.
It's not
There's no use for that. It's not of any use. There are e-waste agencies that you'll have to go to.
So why can't
there is daily dump where, you know, they collect. We collect e-waste. So you come and you drop in your e-waste. We are a certified collection center. So you just drop it there. And then we take it to some other. See, if you do not, that's what I'm trying to say. If you do not have a direct access to, you know, to an agency, at least go and give it at a collection center.
Is that a good business opportunity? People come and drop and how much money do you make?
Nothing. We don't make any money. Out of that. Yeah.
Whoever picks my e-waste gives me money.
They do? I'll give all my e-waste to you. I think you'll make money. Okay, so all of you can ask him where.
I'll send this guy to you.
No, it's really good. You know, if you share his number to all these people,
yeah,
because,
exactly.
You know, it's really good. They all make money. The guy also makes money. Nothing like it. Yeah.
Monitor that is
completely
covered.
Companies
make
money.
Whoa.
That is very less.
No,
that is very less.
Isn't that good? I mean, see, you have an answer already for e-waste.
During these times, there are e-waste bins kept in office. So what you can do is you can carry it.
Yes, most of us work. So why not as a community? You do it. See, when it's done as a community, the value increases. So in your office, go give a suggestion. Why don't we collect all our e-waste? If you have batteries and CDs and floppies we have to use. But if you have those, you can put all of that into one case. And the company then gives it to somebody, and maybe your housekeeping staff will be of, you know, it'll be of help to them. They'll get some more money here. I mean, all of us need incentives. So do they.
to do with the e-waste?
What do you do with the e-waste? Do you recycle it or how?
We give it to an agency that is.
They
separate it. First, they separate the e-waste. I mean, like I showed the slide, right? They segregate into glass, plastic, this kind of, a particular kind of.
Electronic waste or something. What do they do with it?
There are different metals in it. So each one is separated first and then it is reused. So it's all about recycle, reuse. The 3 R's I was talking about. It's all from the book. And you should be happy that there's somebody to do it for you. You don't have to sit at home and do that. Segregate it to that level. Better than throwing a bag, a mixed bag of waste.